Hi folks, well back to the Land Rover a bit sooner than expected. We've got a day off as there's no power at work currently. We struggled on yesterday with electric lanterns, you know, battery lanterns and battery powered lead lights and things, but there's only so much you can do. So hopefully they'll get it back on today. I'm just in the process of cleaning up some winch parts before I go and put the hubs back on the Rover. People always ask how I clean stuff up, so I've started the process here with some Starchem Sin Strip. This is a paint stripper I like. It's very strong, it's an industrial grade really. Stuff like this was in quite good condition, fully painted, and it's lifted all the paint off in about 5 minutes. I've then scraped it off with a sharpened hacksaw blade. And I tend to scrape all the paint onto a bit of tissue paper. It's easier to clean up whatever you've used to contain the parts while you paint strip them. It's the only thing with paint stripping, the cleanup is a bit of a mess sometimes. Now this paint stripper is water washable, so that makes it quite a lot easier. But you can see it's just lifted the paint straight off that winch bollard casting. So we'll clean all that up in a minute and I'll wire brush it outside. Likewise, this aluminium housing was cleaned up by hand. Wire brushes, brass brushes, Scotch-Brite, good cleaning fluid. I use Swarovski Geyser, which is quite expensive, but you don't need very much of it. And again, they now do a water washable one, which can actually be washed down the drain, which is also a problem if you're doing stuff like this at home. But unlike most sort of environmentally friendly things, it really actually does a blooming good job. So I can recommend that. As for paint, all the black bits on this are this Ultratec Satin Black. I keep quite a few of their paints in stock, and a Tetrasil Rattlecan Red Oxide Primer as well. Quick and easy, they're not too expensive, and for this kind of project, I really like it. Quick drying too. So there you go. We'll carry on with this for an hour or two, and hopefully get out on the Rover. And here's the hub going back on. I've just set the end float and knocked the tail washer over. Obviously you should pull the hub back and forth with both hands for a proper reading, but you're allowed 0.05 mm to 0.1 mm end float, so we're right at the minimum, which I've always found is the better way to be setting them like this. 2 to 4 thou, I think that is in English. So I'm just going to put some wheel seal on there, put the half shaft in, and then put the drive member back on. And I'm going to put a little bit of Rocol anti-scuffing paste on the splines at the drive member, just to help them last a little bit longer. And we're pretty much done this side, so I'm going to put the brake drum on now after I've given that a little clean. I can then get the wheel on and we're done this side. I'll then torque everything up once it's on the ground onto the other side. The brake drums are still very serviceable, they've been on a few years now, but there's very little in the way of wear on them. So I've just given them a clean with brake cleaner, and that's it really, that's all we can do with those. And that's it, both hubs and brake assemblies refitted, so we can get onto the front axle now. I'm going to refit the wheels. I've just had a little play with the adjusters and they work fine, so actually I'd forgotten about that. I locked the drums up on the adjusters and then torque these up, and I'll torque the road wheels once it's on the ground. One other little job we have got to do is resettle the springs. We've got a little bit of a lean on at the moment, so I've got to slacken the shackle pins off. And there's actually a description of how to do this in the manual, but basically you can put, there's various ways of doing it, but it suggests either loading the vehicle or putting a chain around the chassis and the axle and reducing this gap here to a specified amount. We'll have to interpret that given the lift that the parabolics give. But we'll torque shackle pins up and it should ride all right then. those bits and pieces for the winch painted yesterday, so I'm just doing the final assembly on the winch. Still need to find a fair lead roller for it, but that's an easy bolt on afterwards. So I've just installed the winch bollard drive gear, put that in the case first, and then lifted the whole unit over the winch bollard and put the key in and circlip. I've used some graphite grease on the gears, seems to work very nicely with that kind of thing, hangs around, and just help it all bed in again nicely. So I'm going to put the cover and gasket on, and then the starter dog, and that's as much as I can do for now. I'm pretty pleased with how that's turned out. Far better than I ever imagined it would, really. I think it's going to be too shiny, if anything. And there's the completed capstan winch, now just missing the fairlead. A guy in Germany's just offered me a roll of fairlead for it for about €40, and so I think he's going to ship that over to me. Should still be reasonable even with the shipping. In terms of what this has cost, there's restored as new winches available online. My project, including buying the winch and all the bits, has come in at less than a quarter of the asking price for those. So it was definitely worth biding my time and waiting for an affordable winch to turn up. I'm not going to paint the lettering on top of the bollard. I think it looks quite good just as it is. I've made up a fixings kit, all stainless bits and pieces, and as soon as the opportunity arises, I'll get it on the Land Rover. There we are. All that remains, I think, is to put a tag on it that says no oil. It takes 2 litres of EP90. I'm going to make some shear pins. You can buy them, but I've got material and I've got a drawing I made of one some time ago, so I might as well just make my own. Save a bit more on the job. I'll certainly film this when I fit it. I'll film the fitting process and hopefully find some way of giving it a bit of a test, which should be interesting. Anyway, I hope you've enjoyed the video, and I think we'll move back to Land Rover hubs and things now. Brakes, stripping down the front axle, that'll be the next thing. Yeah, watch this space, we'll be coming back to this. Hi folks, and welcome back to the workshop. Yeah, nice day outside today for the first time in ages. First sort of blue sky and sunshine day I think we've had this year, so yeah, quite nice. I'm hopefully going to tackle the rear brake pipe on the Land Rover today, which I've been putting off. You know, the original's hanging up on the wall over there. I've been looking at it for ages, and it's a very funny shape. I think we can do a bit better than that. Hopefully that'll make it a bit easier as well. Just opened up the Rover for the first time in about a month, and it was like a scene out of Indiana Jones and all the spiders' webs and everything. But I think I've got rid of all the spiders and webs now. But yeah, let's go and have a look at the vehicle and I'll show you what I'm going to do. Okay, well, this is not going to be the easiest thing to show you, but it's a nice light day so you can see it reasonably well. So all the new brake pipes to the rear axle are in situ, all looking quite nice. And we've got to go from that flexible hose there all the way along that chassis rail. You can see there are some little brake pipe clips. Pass the transmission. Way along. And you can just see the T-pieces poking out up there. We've got to get there. Now, originally, I can't remember how the line ran, and I haven't been able to find much information on it. Books aren't very helpful. But I know that the previous brake pipe went up and over all the cross members, which I imagine could make it difficult to bleed through. So, if you look at the cross members, you can see that the new chassis have cutouts. So I'm intending to run the brake pipe through them and have a straighter run. Now you can see that one there more clearly. We've got to go up and over to the rear flexible, but we can't help that. So my intention is to measure between this cross member here and the gearbox cross member, and that's a straight run. I'm then going to get some aluminium welding wire, which is very flexible, and I'm going to roughly make the shape from the cross member to the hose, and then likewise at the other end from the cross member to the T-piece. And I think I can then work it all out from there, maybe with an inch or two extra on the length, as we've got to just kink round these supports in various places. And that way I can actually measure out the pipe, form the ends on the bench top flaring tool, and that will save me an awful lot of grubbing about under here. So I measured the pipe out to be about 84 inches, that's plus a little bit for forming the ends and bending it round things. So I've measured that out, and I'm now going to form the ends on it before we go and take it to the vehicle. I was doing a bit of work on that old Lister last night. I pulled the flywheel off. I had it running a few weeks ago for the first time, and it sounded terrible. This was a sort of farm find engine, and I really thought that doing the mag and just a bit of tinkering would have it going, but it's turned out to be quite a lot wrong with it, considering how it looked. And having had it running, it was making a dreadful noise, sort of grinding gears noise, and it turned out to be the fuel pump, which was seizing up at certain points and overloading the camshaft. So that's off at the moment. It's all okay in the timing case. And I've got to do a bit of work on the fuel pump. Nice original one though, 1940. Anyway, let's get those ends formed. There we are. One end we have the metric convex flare, and this end we have the double flare. Both metric fittings either end. I remember to put both fittings on as well. So I'm just going to blow a bit of air down this, make sure there's no swarf or anything in it, and then I'm going to take the ends up so that the fittings stay with the end while we feed it through the chassis. Not quite so bright as it was earlier, but I hope you can still see this. So it goes through the chassis and then loops up to the rear. Flexible, quite a loop on that. I hope that isn't going to give me trouble bleeding it. I could probably have lost a couple of inches out of the length, to be honest. But to be fair, the pipe actually used to run right up and over this cross member, taking probably an even bigger sweep and then back down. So if that bled through all right, I'm pretty sure we'll manage this. But we'll see how we go. There we are, it's as neat as I can make it working under the vehicle. And it loops up nicely into the T-piece there. It's secured at all the original points. So I think that should be okay. Vehicle up on stands now. Two heavy ones under the chassis, two extra just taking a bit off the axle. It's nice and solid to work on. Just a bit of a before and after, really. The last all stripped down about 6 years ago. It's done a lot of miles since. In terms of faults, we've got leaking front wheel cylinders, the swivel seals down there are leaking. That's the big seal in the back of the housing. So to replace all that properly, we've got to strip it all anyway. So I've decided to go through the lot again. Replace all the seals and bearings. I want to put some new bearings in these hubs as well. We're also going to replace the track wheel ends. In fact, we're going to replace the whole lot. New flexible pipes, of course, will be fitted. That side's not too bad. It was the other side that was leaking quite well. certainly in the summer it was leaving quite a puddle. People often ask me why I don't have a steering damper fitted. See, we've got the bracket for it there. I find it drives very much better on the road without it. It kind of prevents the steering from self-centering like it should. So that's what I run without. So this is why we're doing the overhaul. It was the front brakes that were really the problem. The vehicle had been pulling left and right a bit, and it was clear that I had sticky wheel cylinders. When I went and got the vehicle MOT'd, as soon as I'd come out of the test station, I could feel it pulling left or right, can't remember which now. Anyway, it was obvious that one of the wheel cylinders had started to leak, probably as a result of the extra pressure applied on the brake roller tests. And it was this side that was quite bad. You can see it's actually sat there leaking quite badly. Look what it's done to the drum. Don't know if I'll get away with using them. I'll have to clean them up and see how they come up. But yeah, it's all a bit of a mess. So yeah, that's what we're doing this. Nice to see that the hubs are still in good condition inside. I just managed to get the split pin out, which is always a bit of a challenge for these, but we now need my special tool to get the half shaft nut off. I believe HNJ Engineering supply one of these now. I made one myself. It's a handy thing to have in the toolbox. And the hubs look to be in good condition, plenty of grease in there, which is pleasing. Something of note, I just want to tell you in case I forget, is these lock washers. If you have Mayflower hubs, the inside diameter is slightly smaller than that of the normal drive flanges, and some of the available lock washers for the wheel bearing nuts are now too large on the OD, which means that you won't be able to refit the hub. If you've just reset your end float on the wheel bearing hubs, that's really annoying. And if you tried to force it, you'd do damage. So I actually had to skinny these ones down on the lathe, if I remember rightly. So yeah, a little problem to keep an eye out for. So I think I mentioned in the last video the trouble I'd had with the brake adjuster pins. You can see this one is just starting to go on the wonk. It's trying to come out. So that's not good. And that's what they've all done at various times. It was a problem with this particular batch of brake shoes. I believe they've now rectified that. Certainly the new ones look better. The adjuster pins have been staked in position much better. So far so good. The off-shelf joints look really good and feel good. A little bit of rust from where it's been standing, but not a lot we can do about that. The grease from the top pin there tends to mix with the oil quite well, so it ends up quite thick, but it seems to be beneficial. Keeps that top pin well greased up. There's a modification I did some time ago. I had this theory that condensation formed in the top of here sometimes and caused the top pin to rust. Nothing to do with having through wheel hubs. I've had it happen with both with and without hubs, so I fitted the greaser. It's never been an issue since. Well, I think that's about it for today. We're losing the light. I've got this side stripped down. I just need to take the swivel unit off now. But yeah, I think it was about time. Put a lot of miles on it since I did all this last, and it was feeling its age, so you can see all the rust in there as well. So we're going to be replacing these anyway. Well, that's not bad for an afternoon's work. I've tackled the job that I put off for ages, that rear brake pipe, and got at least one side stripped down at the front. quite a lot of work ahead of me cleaning this lot up, but pleasingly things like this housing are not too bad. It's not too rusty, and so I shouldn't have to go to too much effort to clean it up. Same with this brake back plate. The rear ones were really bad, but these aren't too scabby, so it should be a bit less effort required on these, which is nice. Where the time will be, I think, is these hubs. I'm going to make some new bearings for them, I think. I seem to remember they had a bit of play when I took them apart. So I've got some bronze blanks to make the bushes from already. First thing I'm going to do is sort through it all and discard parts like this that I'm replacing. It's got a bit of wear on that pin and it's really quite rotty. Now the grease has kept it free, but it's still corroded in there. So that's not very nice. I suppose it was about 60,000 miles ago that I did the front axle overhaul. So to be replacing a few seals and bearings at this stage, I guess, isn't too bad on what is quite an antiquated sort of vehicle. The brake shoes go back a lot further than that. They've got 65,000-70,000 miles on them. So they're not too bad. Anyway, a lot of work ahead. As I say, I'm going to discard the bits that I'm going to replace, and that'll make it look a bit less daunting. Hi folks, and welcome back to the workshop. It's been a little while since I got to work on the Land Rover. I'm just really busy at the moment, but I'm trying to progress the project so that we're done with this and it's back on the road by mid-April. There's one or two engine rallies by that time, and it's needed for that. Yeah, we're going to have a look at the swivel units today, or more specifically the near side. I'm working kind of on each side at a time. You don't risk any cross-contamination between parts then. I collected up all the bits for this about September, but nonetheless I've managed to forget the axle case seals, so we won't be putting it together this weekend. We did this last about 6 years ago, but not quite so extensively, maybe a little longer than that. The half shaft bearing in there has fared well. I found the top pin had come out quite worn, and there's quite a lot of corrosion gone on, and this is just all year use, winter driving particularly. They salt the roads very, very heavily in the winter, and it certainly doesn't do things like this any good. It's also interesting to note just how brinelled the lower bearing is. If we have a look at that, you might be able to see it, but yeah, it's not brilliant. So definitely time for a bit of an overhaul. I've cleaned up all the bits we're going to reuse. I've got a little fixture that I've made up to assemble these on. I can clamp that in the vise, and that will allow me to torque all the bolts up properly and then just transfer them across the vehicle. One little modification I quite like is greases on the top pins, and I've been running that. It's just drilled through one side. I've been running that on the vehicle for the last 5 years or so. I was having trouble with the top pins going slightly rusty, and that was with both freewheel hubs and without. I've had the same problem regardless, and this is where the top of the housing suffers a bit of corrosion, and I think that you get condensation. Now this housing's upside down, but condensation around that area, and while the vehicle's standing, it will cause issues. So I added the greases, and I've never had any problems since. I just give them a little turn at each service. So when I change the engine oil, about every 3,000 miles, and that's enough. So as you can see, more original bits that I've cleaned up. Brake pipe bracket. Yeah, there's a few things that people commonly forget with these units. The first is that they leave out the washer that goes under the top pin, and then they wonder why they can't get any preload. Very easy to miss that on the diagrams. There's an O-ring that goes on that bottom pin. Another common one is questions about where the shims go. We'll have a look at that in a minute. new retainer, I've painted that just to give it a fighting chance. New seals, fixings, a lot really. So I think without further ado, we should look at the information available and put it together. So when I first started with this vehicle, I just had the Haynes manual, which is not a bad guide to be fair. I manage very well with that, but there are some, how should we say, continuity errors between that and the workshop manuals. This is the Series 3 workshop manual. I think this is like a 1988 publication. It's one of the late ones anyway. So it's got all the modifications and so on that were made over time. And it's got quite a bit of information on overhauling swivel units. Everything you need to know. The torque figures are given in the front for all the fastenings. It gives quite a few of them as you go. Importantly, it gives you this figure here of 8 to 10 pounds preload on the swivel unit, and that's very important. The reason for the preload is to try and stop wheel wobble. You need a little bit of damping in the steering mechanism to keep it all smooth, or the steering can get oscillations going on. So if you've got that, typically you've lost preload on the swivel units, and it shows here a spring balance being used to set that. So that's one piece of perhaps unusual equipment that you might not have, so that's worth it's worth acquiring a good one. I've got some old Salter ones, but you'll see that later. Another common thing that people do, I actually did it myself this time, I put the bearings in the swivel unit in the actual ball bit round the wrong way. It looks somewhat unnatural, but the housing, well, I can show you here. The housing's upside down, so you can see how when it's the right way round, it sort of corrects that alignment, all to do with the steering geometry. Anyway, much the same information in the Haynes manual, but what it does say, if I can just find it, it says there that the spring balance should show you a pull of 14, 16 pounds when the preload is set correctly. Well, as I've just shown you, 8 to 10 pounds is given in the handbook, and I've certainly found that these lower figures make the vehicle drive much better. It could be a little wandery if the preload is too high, so that's an important one to get right. I've just looked at a book that I've got printed in the 60s on Land Rover maintenance, and it gives that figure for the old Cone and Bush type setup. Which is on the like Series 1s and Series 2s, I think. Also, it's really worth having the parts book. I don't know how I ever managed without one of those. They're about 30 quid, they're not the cheapest thing. You can get all this online if you go to the LR Workshop website, but it's quite convenient to have the book. And there were so many little changes made over the time. It's worth having this. Now, I mentioned shims under the bottom pin. People often ask about that, and it's easy to see why. The Haynes manual says that shims do not go under the bottom pin where the steering arm goes. I might add that early models had the steering arm on the top, Series 2s. Anyway, the book here shows a shim underneath as required, and the manual doesn't say anything about that. So the only thing I can conclude from past experience is that we should get it all together minus shims and see if the swivel ball is central in the housing. I actually had trouble before getting this seal to sit nicely on the swivel ball, so it might be that we have to add a shim to get that right and do the same thing either side. So we'll work with no shims on the bottom pin for the time being, and if we have to fit them to centralise that, then that's what we'll do. Having sat and thought about it, that seems like a sensible way to go on. Let's put a few bits together. The very first thing we need to do is check these studs, and I've actually already done this. These studs should be Loctited into the housing. So you lock two nuts together and wind them in and torque to 40 to 50 pound foot. I Loctited these in last time, I can't shift them, so I'm going to leave those well alone. Now we need to fit the swivel arm or steering arm to the bottom of the outer swivel housing. You can see that you can't really get it wrong if you've got the correct hand and you haven't mixed the near side and offside parts, because it's got a cutout there for the drain bung. Now, I'm going to fit that without any sealant for the time being, without the lock tabs, just bolt it up tight and then get the preload set. And when I'm happy with it all, I'll take it apart again and seal and lock tight the fixings. Now, the reason being that if I do need to put some shims underneath, it'll be a right pain having to do all that again. A lot easier if I just haven't put Loctite and sealant on it in the first place. Alright, well, you can see my swivel fixture. Very simple, really. Obviously, this is going to have to come off again to fit the seal and retainer, but it'll help me set the preload properly and accurately. And, you know, it's not going anywhere in the vice. The lower arm is on the outer swivel unit now, minus seal, sealant, Loctite, etc. It's just on there, with the bolts nipped up, just so that it's sitting flush with the housing and good enough for me to do my preload check. So the first thing we're going to do is just get this taper roller bearing, which goes up in here. Now, I might add, I've already fitted the Ralco bush and the lower tapered bearing race some time ago. Self-explanatory, really. You can warm the housing up in the oven at home if that helps. That's quite a good way of doing it. Put both of these in the freezer and they should practically drop in. I just press mine in, having access to a press. Anyway, lower bearing goes straight on there, and it is that loose. It's meant to be like that. Next thing is just a little bit of EP90 around the Ralco bush. And then the little Tufnell thrust washer, we can drop that in the bottom. Give that a bit of oil as well. And that's it. Now, I might add, I made a little mistake with my greasable pins, and that I drilled right through, and I'd forgotten that there's a hole right through the bush and the thrust washer. So if you do that, you really want to stop short of the end and then cross drill. But anyway, I've machined a tiny little plug, Loctited that in there, and then just staked over the metal so that it's not going to come out, and put a Cobrundum stone over that to make sure it's perfectly flat. So that was fine. If you do drill these, keep the holes as small as possible. There's only really a couple of turns of thread holding the greaser in there, so it's only drilled very shallow. And then the smallest drill, I think I used, was it a 16th drill? Anyway, it was tiny right the way down through, which takes a bit of care, I might add. So you can see that that's quite a good snug fit. The one that came out of the old swivel, it actually worn quite badly and was really quite loose, so that's good. So the next thing we're going to do, I've put a bit of oil around that lower bearing. We're just going to hang this in place like that, and then making sure it's nice and clean, drop that top pin in. Doesn't matter which way around anyway. So obviously no shims at the moment. What I'm going to do is just wind the bolts up just until I start to feel a bit of resistance, and then I'm going to take a measurement of the clearance between the top pin and the housing. And that'll give me some idea of what shim pack I should start out with. for measuring the preload, you're going to need a spring balance of some description. I really like these old Salter ones. I've got quite a collection of these in my toolbox, different ranges. They're quite useful for setting preloads and checking spring tensions, that kind of thing, and for my various restoration activities. I need quite a variety of these, and they're very useful. I bought this one for this job. It reads up to £20, so we want, I think it was somewhere between £8 and £10, I said. I'll double check before we do it. But you really want one where the working range you're looking for is right in the middle of the scale. I've just checked these for accuracy. I haven't checked them for a while. I normally do check things like this every now and again, just as a precaution. I used to work in aviation, so you know, a bit of care was a good thing. To check them, I got a carton of milk, you know, one of those plastic milk bottles with a handle on it, and that meant I could just hook this on the handle, stood them on the kitchen scales, measured out various quantities of water into them, you know, different weights, £3, £5, £8, that sort of thing, and then check both scales. Both of these reading exactly the same, and that's what I found with stuff like this. They're quite accurate, really. Forget the modern cheap Chinese rubbish, forget the digital ones, these will do very nicely. And then you can just get a paint pen, mark the range you're looking for, and then while you're doing the job, it's easy to see if you're in the right shop. We're actually near £8 there, as I've tightened these down, just so happens it's nearly right. So I'm going to take a measurement of that now with my feeler gauges. Well, even simpler than that. What we can do is get the shims and, as usual, they never supply enough shims, so we need some of the old ones as well. I have got packets of new ones I bought last time, so discard the old rusty ones. See where we end up. We will have to adjust this, it will not be right first time. There is a bit of faffing about to be done when you do this. Okay, well, I'm going to start with that pack and see what happens. Obviously there's a torque setting for those, but I can feel that that's way too tight. Yeah, about £16, so that's actually up at the figure given in the Haynes manual. But that's really quite some effort required to do that, so that would make it a pretty unpleasant drive. Have those out, add another shim. So I've spent about 20 minutes fiddling about with shims, and I seem to have it about right now. I've snugged all the bolts up, quite well, but the next thing to do is torque them properly. I've put some paint pen marks on the spring balance, so hopefully you can see that. Try about there, you might just see it. And it needs to be reading 8 to 10 pounds pull, which you can see pretty much all the way, 8 to 10. Once moving, the reading is taken. Once the thing's moving, the constant pull required to turn the housing, obviously it takes a bit more effort, in this case about 16 pounds to make it move. So there you go, 8 to 10, pretty well all the way. So I'm going to just torque them up now and see if it's still sensible. By the way, you take the reading off the track rod, the hole for the track rod. On the near side you've got this one here for the drag link that goes to the steering relay, and that one for the track rod. So obviously this steering arm on the other side is shorter and just has that one. Obviously you'd get quite a different reading if you went off that one. Creep up on it too much. We'll just check them at the higher end of the torque and make sure I haven't over torqued them actually. Where are we? 59, 60. Okay. Bit more to be had on those yet, that's fine. So we're somewhere in the torque setting there. £9 all the way. Yeah, rod in the right shot, so I think that's that bit done. So what we do now is take that apart. It should all torque down a lot better with everything properly greased up, copper slipped and so on. These lock washers, I've had problems with these before where they're actually quite soft, but with everything greased up a bit, it'll all torque up a bit nicer. I think we can be confident now, it's going to be fine. Well, this is probably the largest seal on the vehicle. This is a swivel seal, goes around the back of the ball there, that way round. And obviously we have to put it on from behind, so the whole swivel unit, if you've got to change this, really has to come off the vehicle. People do sometimes split them and fill the gap up with RTV, that sort of thing. It can work. Proper way to do it is take the whole thing apart, unfortunately. I've just taken the box out, that's going to come off of there. Goes in the back of the housing like that with the retainer plate over it. I fitted the last ones with plenty of RTV, which I smeared around the gap. I'll do that when it's all together, a bit difficult, but you can do it, and that then will make a nice seal. There is a little bit of free play on that in the housing, and it does say in the book that you can get some adjustment if you can't get a good seal. I actually had a look while the housing was on there, and the gap around the swivel ball looked quite uniform, so it's never perfect, but I think it'll do the job. So I'm just going to pack a load of grease in the lip of the seal, and that's ready to fit. As you can see, the half shaft bearings in there, or at least the outer race. I'm kind of hoping to just use the half shafts as they are. The bearing races on them have got no marks, and they're exactly the same bearings, same manufacturer. If it was someone else's vehicle, I'd change the race as well, but I'm sort of tempted to see if I can get away with it. I've tried the bearing races in both old and new bearings and they feel the same, both perfectly smooth. I know I shouldn't do it really, but it would save an awful lot of work, but we'll revisit that later and I'll make my decision. If I have to change them, not the end of the world, done it before so we can do it again. Right, the seal is packed with grease, so that goes on that way. If anything, the grease helps them over like that. And then the retainer. I could do all this after I've done the assembly, but I want to do it on the fixture just to tighten everything up properly. That has a top and bottom. You can see the cutouts for the oil drains. There's the steering arm. I've put the O-ring on it, smeared a bit of RTV on the sealing face. The manual actually says use a Loctite on both the studs and the sealing face, which it will kind of fill the gap. I think it's a Loctite flange sealant that they recommend, but anyway, the studs are Loctited into the housing. I'm not going to Loctite the nuts, just torque them properly and rely on the lock tabs. I've done that before, works fine. And the RTV should just prevent any unwanted oil leaks. So I've fitted that bottom steering arm properly now. A bit of RTV sealant in there, as I said, it all squeezed out nicely, so I've cleaned that up. And I've just torqued the bolts, 60 pound foot. The torque is 50 to 65 pound foot on these nuts, rather. I just did that by standing on it, quite honestly. It's a lot easier to do that first with it off the unit there, and we can then check them finally. Anyway, pop the bearing on, seals are in place, I've just put a bit of grease around the bearings, and that's it, we can start assembly. Copper slipped all the bolts already. So we'll get our shim pack. Just put a little bit of grease on the mating faces on the pin and the housing here, because I might want to re-shim. I think I did last time after a few thousand miles, just recheck the preload. Shouldn't really be necessary, but we'll see what happens this time. Bolts do have a tendency to bite into these lock tabs, but we're there now. That's it, and we'll just check the ones underneath again. Yep, happy with that. So now we'll do a final check on the preload. Showing about 9 all the way. So well within the 8 to 10 specified. Feels nice, so very happy with that. Cool, so we'll pack some sealant in there now. Lock tab, fit the retainer, and there's a little brake pipe bracket that goes up there. So we better do the lock tabs first. Yeah, very nice. Easy to be a bit overzealous with lock tabs. People tend to punch them hard against the flat, and they end up with a sharp 90 degree edge and a bit prone to shearing off. So drive them over at the top. In this case, I think none of the bolts have really lined up in quite the ideal position. So I've just tapped the lock tabs to the shape of the bolt head right at the top. So they shouldn't be prone to shearing off or anything like that. Just filled up the greaser, and I'm now going to pop the seal retainer on. I've just got some RTV sealant in the groove where the seal's going to sit. Trying to keep it off the swivel ball. I think I've succeeded there. This is the stuff that I use, Loctite SI5980 black silicon. They do a grey one as well. In fact, I think they do a fairly numerous range of colours. I did a little test where I just stuck the seal in there first and watch to see the seal lip, what it did when I pressed the seal in, and you can see it sort of press outwards all around, so the seal is actually making nice contact. So I'm quite pleased about that. It's worked out a lot better than the last one did. So there's one bolt that takes the steering stop, I think it's that one. Put this one in first. These have all got a plain washer and a spring washer, just like they should have. Brake pipe bracket goes on here. So your seal adds to the preload a little bit, but the correct procedure is to set the preload without the seal. I can see that's wiping nicely around the entire swivel housing. Where I've packed it with grease, you can see it wiping grease all around. So that should be really good. But it leaks. Right, we need that stop bolt now then. So now we can fit the stop bolt. There should be a little BSF set screw just like these, but a bit longer. It goes in here with a nut. And what you've got to do is measure 1/2 inch between the housing and the bolt head. So that's about right. In my case, it lost its thread a long time ago. I think the bolt got ripped out, but I found an M6 set screw locked with a nut, works just as well. Anyway, we'll tighten that in a minute, but what happens is there's a little lug that goes on the bolts where this attaches to the axle, and it just meets that, comes round, and it avoids A, the tyre rubbing on anything, and B, overstressing the steering box. So that's it, pretty well all together. Oh, I've got a drain bung to put in, but that's it really. So just to demonstrate the extra preload that the seal puts on. It's taking about 14 pounds now to pull that round rather than 9 or 10. So of course in time that will sort of settle in, but that's the process that's laid down in the manual. You set the preload without the seal and then fit it. So that should be correct. But feels nice, nice and smooth. So if we can get them both like that, it should drive really nicely, I would think. That's the swivel housing done, as far as we can go with that. So I'm turning my attention to the brake back plate, which is painted, and I want to assemble cylinders and springs onto it and the shoes. I've just freed off the adjusters and given them a drop of oil. Someone was asking on one of the Facebook groups when I put up a picture of the rear brakes about leading and trailing edges, and I assured them that the new shoes don't come with linings arranged as such. In the old days certainly you'd line all the shoes up and you'd see some linings would be sort of shorter or in different positions than others, and that was to do with the leading and trailing shoes. But Mintex are supplying shoes now with basically the same linings, so we need to look at how we determine which ones go where. Having studied the new shoes, they are all the same, the difference being that of course one gets kind of inverted for the top and bottom cylinders, just exactly the same as the old ones, so kind of difficult to get wrong. Having completed the swivel, I went on and put together the brake back plate, fitted the new cylinders. I took the rubber boots off, packed a bit of red rubber grease in there just to give them a chance. These ones are a bit easier to assemble than the rears, since the springs go to a solid post. They have changed the design of these shoes very slightly. These holes are different, but I just measured from the centre of the end of the brake shoe to each hole and worked out where the springs should go. I'm quite confident I've got that right. Somewhat annoyed to see that they haven't corrected the issue with the brake shoes where the pins are easily knocked out. So what I've done is to knock them out, Loctite them in, and then heavily stake the metal around the pin, and they're really in there now. If they come out, I'll be very surprised. So hopefully I won't have any more trouble with those. I don't think I'll be buying another set of Mintex brake shoes, so anyway, we'll see how we get on. The next thing, of course, is pipe work. There's a pipe that goes to the flexible hose, which mounts there, and then another one that runs all the way down to the lower cylinder. So I've just got the brake pipe making kit, and I'm going to make another one of those, and the one that's currently fitted. Nothing really wrong with these, but the fittings are a bit manky, and since I've renewed everything else, might as well do them. There we are, that's a fair old improvement. These ones are a bit challenging just because of the tight radius the pipes take, but I made them as well. What I did was I straightened out the originals, just leaving the bends in that one, and made them up like that. Much easier to get the length. And then once I'd worked out the approximate route, took the back plate off again and got the route right. And my bends are not quite as tight as what was on there, but that was copper pipe, and this Gibra nickel stuff won't bend quite that tight. It just tucks into the gap at the side of the lower swivel pin, so yeah, it's just all right, just clears it. So I'm going to take that brake back plate off again and just tighten them up properly, and then that's ready to fit when the time comes. Obviously all this has got to come off in order to fit the half shaft, but I now know that everything lines up, it all fits together, and we can move on and do the other side. And that's it all tightened up and to the right profile. So next we'll have a look at the free wall hub for this side and see if that needs any work. Oh yeah, you might have noticed the stud there is different. I tightened up the nut on that one. That wheel cylinder actually stripped the thread. Didn't do it very tight, it just stripped. Just usual poor quality. Highly annoying, but I had to extract a stud from the original cylinder and swap it in. Loctite it into the casing. Yeah, could have done without that. And now we come to the free wheel hubs. A bit of a can of worms. People love them or hate them. I like them personally for various reasons. But in this case, the Mayflower or Map hubs are just a nice period accessory. Perhaps not appropriate for a Series 3. These are a bit earlier than my vehicle, but I rather like them. And I've got a rear 24 spline set of hubs. I didn't think I'd have to do too much to these, but I knew when I gave them a bit of restoration 2 years ago that there was a little bit of play in the bronze bush inside. Now, unlike AVMs and worn hubs, these have a bronze bush rather than roller bearings, so they're quite hard wearing. But once these develop a little bit of play, they can have problems. And you can see some of the spare bushes I've got here that I've taken out of other hubs. They've really worn quite badly, you can see that ridge. Now, I've explained before more fully in another video on overhauling these hubs, what I do with these. This is a original hub housing, and this is one that I've modified slightly. So you can see what a tight fit that rotor is in the housing. There's virtually no clearance. In fact, that diameter almost ends up as a bearing diameter running on the aluminium housing, as well as that diameter that's running in the bush. And what seems to happen on every set I've seen, and you might see it on these, is that where the housing's been contacted by the rotor, you end up with hardened material from the rotor, which is probably nitrided, embedded in the aluminium housing. And it's this weird phenomenon where a soft metal causes the hard metal to break up, but that's what happens. A bit like with cam followers sometimes. And you get all those, well, you can see it more clearly on that one, all those bits of metal. And then they seize up. And the rotors suffer terribly. So they're generally quite a nice thing, but if they'd just given them a bit more clearance from the start, they'd last an awful lot longer. And so with mine, I've just machine the housing out, so provided the bearing's in good nick, this surface here is not contacting the housing, and naturally that will put more wear on the bearing, but I can live with that for them not seizing up. So anyway, as you'll see, once you get a little bit of play in the bearing, they tend to wear oval. That's it, you've got to do something about it, else you get that trouble again. And that is typified by when the vehicle is driving along at low speed, you'll hear a clicking noise from the hubs. And it will be these little engagement blocks clipping the rotor. And you can see where that's happened in the past, the sort of worn edge. A little bit chipped. You can't get these, so you know, you have to use the best ones you can get. And the same with this rotor, there's some little chunks taken out of it. It still works fine, doesn't affect it really. But that's the damage that can occur. So these do actually need a bit of careful looking at if you're going to get good use out of them. Anyway, I was rather hoping that some of my spare bearings here were going to be good enough, but they're not. They've still got a bit of play. I really want something a little bit tighter than that. So I have actually got some bronze or oilite bushes for this, which need to be modified slightly to fit. So we'll have a look at doing that today and hopefully get one of these back together. Well, I've just made the first of the new bearings. Not the first time I've done this. You might have seen my video on restoring a set of these hubs before for someone else. I've done a couple of sets now with these oilite bushes and they're running along very nicely. Both vehicles these are on are in daily use. I'm quite happy to fit a set to mine as well. I'd have done it long ago, to be honest, but this is the first opportunity that's come up to do it. So they've got about 2 thou clearance. That'll just close up a little bit when they're pressed in. It may be that I have to hone them to the final size. But the beauty of the Oarlite bushes is that with late series Land Rover axles like I've got, they've got an intermediate seal. So these hubs don't see any oil like they would on an earlier model. And there's no means of lubricating these. Earlier hubs often had a little plug which you removed and you could drop some oil in. So hopefully the Oarlite bushes will just prevent them from running dry, as they do appear to do so. I pack them with grease, but that needs renewing quite frequently really. Anyway, we'll press that in and see how we get on. So I've just had to hone the bush out to get a good fit. Bit of running clearance. Amazing how much it closes up when you push that in there. But as you can see from the tool running near the hub runs true on the bearing. These are a bit of a funny shape, these hubs. I thought they were a bit out, but actually it's the bore there that matters. And this face here, and as you can see, it's all nice and square. Running true, so happy with that. Clean them up finally and put them together. There we are, I've just popped the hub together. No clicking when I rotate it in the free position, so I think we're all good. And it operates and locks into the fixed position quite satisfactorily. I've got a set of new gaskets. Now I just need to find some felt washers, and that's ready to fit. I'm really trying to press on with this now. Some of the steam rallies and so on are fast approaching. The new season will soon be upon us. And I really want to get this done now. It's dragged on all winter. I've done a lot of work, but nonetheless, it's time it was all back in one piece. So last night I went out and caught the last sort of half hour of daylight, and eventually, working by lamplight, stripped the offside swivel and brake unit in about hour and 15, I think, which was pretty good going. All the bolts around here are a right tussle, they always are. They're conveniently just a bit longer than the nuts so that they rust. So we'll take that apart tonight, hopefully, start cleaning things up. Half shaft's perfect, nothing to do with that. And all this stuff is a little bit better than the other side was. The near side always seems to suffer more. And once again, PA Blanchards have come to my rescue, and they've supplied a couple of new old stock seals. I forgot to order the actual case seals. I'm not actually sure about using old seals. I much prefer new rubber components, but they still feel fine. And I've never had a problem with anything they've supplied me. Really good service, and it's such a shame that they're closing down. But there you are. So we better get that taken apart. That was fairly easy. All a bit nasty in there, a bit rusty, and quite greasy. As you can see, I made the mistake of drilling right through the pins when I fitted the greases. And they have kind of worked. The top bush is greasy, but of course it's forced lots of grease through into the housing, and you can see that. Not really an issue, it won't do the slightest bit of harm to anything in there. If not, it might do a bit of good. But on the new ones, I've rectified that. I hadn't appreciated that there was a hole right through the Ralco bush and the thrust washer. So there we go. But yeah, nonetheless, they're quite warm. What have I done on those? Probably 60 odd thousand miles. But I am surprised. I measured the other one and it was 20 thou out of round, which is half a mil. So, you know, pretty bad. So yeah, I'm glad I decided to replace all that. I think when you've owned a vehicle like this a long time, it's easy to remember everything you've done, and you know, in your mind it's better than it really is. But in reality, I did all this a long time ago and a lot of miles ago. Yeah, lots of clean up to do. Well, here we are again, back at the weekend again. I have managed to get the offside swivel and brake unit stripped over the course of this week. All the bits and pieces cleaned up and painted, and we've got all the bits to put it all together again. So I'm hoping to do that today, and then I'll have a complete kit of front swivel and brakes to put together onto the vehicle. Just before we get into that, I wanted to show you these old cylinders, which I've cleaned up a couple of bits so you can see them. I've not been exactly religious about changing the brake fluid. It's such a pain to do on a Series 3 long wheelbase, but I have done it a few times. But nonetheless, I'm quite shocked at the poor condition of these cylinders. They obviously have got quite a bit of, there has been quite a bit of moisture in the brake fluid. So it's a good thing that we've replaced the entire brake system. I will definitely be changing the brake fluid more often in the future. I'm just going to use DOT 4. I'm not going to use that silicon stuff, which doesn't absorb moisture. That one's totally stuck in there. But yeah, good advert for regularly changing your brake fluid. Amazing it was stopping at all, really, but it really wasn't that bad. I think it's going to be quite a revelation when it's all back together, though. I'm not going to show you assembling the second swivel, exactly the same operation as the other side. So I'll show you when that's all done. And that's the second swivel and brake unit completed, pipework made and ready to fit. Just got to do the free wheel hub for this side now and repack the bearings in the wheel hub. If I can get all that done tonight, we can actually start putting it all together. Well, there we are. It's well into the night now, but I've made the new bush for the free wheel hub. Prepared all the bits and pieces for assembly. Swivel built, brake backplate built, and ready to go on. So I might actually get the swivel units on tomorrow morning. That'd be nice. I think we'll end this one here. So next time we'll have a look at assembly onto the vehicle. Thanks for watching.